Hi, this is Ozzy Osbourne, and you're listening to Talking Metal.
Silly Ozzy. Actually, you're watching Talking Metal on Fuse. Fuse is bringing the number one metal podcast, Talking Metal, to TV for the very first time. Watch as our hosts, John and Mark, hang with some of the biggest names in metal. Dave Mustaine, Serj Tankian, Nikki Sixx, Bumblefoot and Frank of Guns N' Roses, Kirk from Down, Mondo Generator, and more. Broadcasting from New York, New York, this is Talking Metal on Fuse. Your hosts, John and Mark.
Yo. Hi, I'm Mark Strigl.
I'm John Astronomy.
John, how are you?
Doing great, man. I'm so psyched to be here doing Talking Metal on Fuse.
We have a lot of great people in the studio. We got Bud Friendly helping us out. We got
in the flesh, baby.
We got Mr. Metal Mike, Sebastian
hello.
Box Band,
Hal
Crawford. A new record coming out when?
November 20th.
November
Fame
20th.
Museum.
Fame Museum.
Metal Mike.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Cool. And we have a bunch of members of the Talking Metal family. We're going to get to you guys in a bit. John and I started a podcast back about 2.5 years ago, and it somehow became the number one heavy metal hard rock podcast in the world. And we were approached by Fuse recently about coming on and doing a TV version of it. So welcome to the TV version of it.
We actually started this in my bedroom, and believe it or not, we had guests coming into the bedroom. We had a couple of stools and we had a computer, and now we're in a professional recording studio. And we're really psyched that we've got an entire cast of people here. Check these guys
out. Give it up for the people.
Let's get into the interview. We got a lot of great interviews tonight.
Tons of great
I was a little
stuff.
Nervous going into the Dave Mustaine thing, interviewing one of the major players of metal.
Yeah,
who practically invented a lot of aspects of
Dave
modern
Mustaine,
metal.
originally in Metallica, and went to Megadeth, and basically I've been a fan of his for, dare I say, 20 years.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Me too.
Mark and I have actually been doing what we're doing now since back in the 80s, and we actually saw you together April 88 at the Orpheum Theater in Boston. So far, so good, so what tour.
One of the best concerts I ever saw.
I just wanted to thank you for all this great music, and the thing about this new album, United Abominations, is that this, to me, sounds like classic Megadeth. I can pick several tracks off of this that I just think are unbelievable.
Thanks.
Yeah, and I'll
say it's like Prozac then.
Yeah, it is. When you feel there's something's wrong, a shelter you would keep you warm. I'll
never let you walk alone. I love you when you still hated me. This has been a lot of questioning the decisions that I've had to make in my band, and frankly, it's not that hard to figure out. If you have one vision, you go in one direction, there's no problems. If someone's trying to steer the vehicle this way, well, there's a door, right? Get out. We're going this way. And we've always had a common vision. Right now, the vision that we all have, the drovers eat, breathe, live metal. They know the songs. They know the entire catalog of all of the back of music.
That's amazing. Well,
I'm getting harassed by these guys to add two new songs in right now. We were going to add Ashes in Your Mouth into the set and Scald Me at the Skin, which is a great classic from way back in the day.
Before the interview, the night before the interview, you were saying you stayed up all night.
Yeah, I had the new album, and I said, well, which song am I going to learn off of this? So I picked the title track of the album, which I think is one of my favorite all-time Megadeth riffs. That part is crazy. Are you playing a harmony or that? There were a few parts of the song that I wasn't exactly sure. I have a pretty good ear, but I figured I'd go ask Dave how to play it.
Shoot, I don't remember how to play that song. Last time I played that was in the studio.
Instead of him showing it to me, he asked me how to play the song.
How's that song go? Okay.
I'm going the octave, right?
That's what I was saying.
we go into the studio to create stuff, we work on the song, we build the song, we turn it into what it is, we record it, and then let it go.
Sorry, I'm not retarded. I'm just trying to learn the song again.
And then you had a chance to just request songs from Dave Mustaine, which, how cool is that?
All right,
I remember when you guys did the PMRC rant.
It was cool to just see him bust the riff right out, right in front of me. I like when he was talking about when he first started singing.
I started actually singing on New Year's Eve in 1983. I'd never sang before that, except, you know, what I said when I was doing backup vocals in Metallica.
Right.
You know, so...
Running.
That's a real hard background vocal, isn't it? Going from that point on, it's just learning about the whole process. It's difficult. You know, if you're not a frontman, if you're not a singer and you have to learn how to do stuff like that, you know, the whole circular breathing and stuff. Besides, you know, as soon as you go from being a guitar player to a frontman too, you've got to learn how to be a cock. So, you know, to be that whole arrogant frontman kind of guy.
Was it hard for you back when you first started doing the singing? I mean, some of the guitar parts are so complicated, I would say, to also be singing on top of it.
I didn't write the songs based on me singing over the top of them.
Right.
So the first record was pretty much being written with guitar playing being predominantly my focus.
Those riffs are really intricate, as Metal Mike, I'm sure, knows.
Yes, absolutely. I spent, you know, my time listening to these records that kind of shaped me as a guitar player, too. That's when I started playing guitar, when, like, these cells came out.
This interview was great. We spoke about tattoos.
Unfortunately, James McDonough, the last bass player we had, he was a temporary guy. He goes, man, I think I'm gonna go get myself a tattoo. Gets a big Megadeth tattoo on the back of his leg and got fired a couple months later. I was like, get tall socks.
You spoke about politics.
Why can't we go back to the day where dudes had swords and rode horses and, you know, the right guy left?
He spoke about being a dad.
I love my kids. I can afford to have them out here all the time. But I want them to have a better life than me. I want them to excel in school. I want them to do good in business. I want them to have morals and values and stuff like that. And do I want my daughter coming out here and seeing girls lift up their top? No. Do I mind girls lifting up their top?
No.
No. I don't.
Talking Metal doesn't mind that either, so, you know.
My bra doesn't match my panties.
Mustaine is great. He was busting on me a little bit, but friendly. I don't know if you can see this, but at one point he was, like, elbowing me.
Oh, it's a good thing I didn't see your shoes before we filmed this.
My?
His.
Oh, his.
Oh, I'm sorry.
All right.
That's why. Brian Setzer knew you had the shoes.
Great, thank you.
He was just a really cool guy. So for a person that we went in being a little nervous about, turned out to be one of the coolest people we've ever met.
Coming up.
Talking Metal calling.
A first time for Nikki Sixx.
This is kind of, now I've never done this.
A revealing moment with Nick Oliveri.
I took off all my clothes.
An awkward moment with Serj Tankian.
So, sorry, that threw me off.
Plus, more from members of Arch Enemy, Down, and Guns N' Roses.
Hey, yo, what's up, man?
How you doing?
We are ready to go, man.
Frank, how you doing?
When Talking Metal on Fuse continues. But first, a word from the metal fans. It's I Got Something to Say.
Dave Mustaine is my guy. He's guy.
The only reason Metallica is even around is because of Dave Mustaine. And that's that.
He's like the best player ever.
He wrote the first album. If it weren't for him, there would be no Metallica. And it's not Four Horsemen. It's Mechanics. End of story. That's it. Yeah.
on this day in history, December 31st, 1973.
So let's rock and roll all night and party every day!
On December 31st, 1973, Kiss played what some refer to as their first professional rock concert. They opened for Blue Oyster Cult and Iggy and the Stooges at the Academy of Music in New York City. You show us everything you got. Despite the fact that Kiss were relatively unknown, their manager, Bill LeCoin, surprised them by hanging a 10-foot Kiss logo above the stage. Needless to say, the headliners were not happy. An unexpected moment occurred during Firehouse when Gene Simmons performed this fire-breathing trick on stage for the very first time. In a review of the show, Fred Kirby of Variety said, "It almost proved disastrous as the hair of the bass guitarist, lead vocalist Gene Simmons, weirdest in makeup, caught fire. A roadie quickly covered it without a note being missed."
"17 rolls of aluminum foil later, and you're aced."
Talking Metal toast to Kiss, one of the greatest bands
absolutely
ever, if not
toast
the
guys
greatest band
that
ever.
Was excellent. That was a funny part.
What's the first concert you ever saw?
First concert I ever saw was actually Queensryche and Twisted Sister, but the second concert I saw was Kiss and Accept at Stanley Theater in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania in 1984. I wanted to go to some earlier concerts, but although my parents are like huge Kiss fans and you know, have been spotted backstage, my mom has been spotted backstage with Gene Simmons, of course.
Not something I would admit about my own mother.
I'm serious.
But she was just hello.
She was speaking with him, right,
backstage.
Right. Yeah, my father was is a Kiss fan too. My dad loves Kiss, my mom loves Kiss. Back in the younger days, I really couldn't get to the show. So the first show I saw was the Lick It Up tour when they took off the main cup.
The first rock concert I ever went to it was Motley Crue and Saxon at the Aragon Ballroom in Chicago. To this day, one of my favorite rock moments.
It was insane to hang out with Nikki Sixx.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was amazing to meet up with this guy that I idolized and had been seeing in concert on a consistent level since 1984. To get in a car with him, and basically it was you, Nikki, and me, and we rode up to
the back seat of a van.
I've never done this.
This is crazy. Right. An interview in a van, going to your signing for the amazing book, The Heroin Diaries.
In New York City, my favorite city in the world.
We talked about The Heroin Diaries, which is an amazing book.
I've been carrying this book with me for 7 days in a row, showing it to everybody. And when I finished, not the book, but just your last entry for your diary, I was crying at a bar in the Empire State Building.
Wow. See, because it's like it's touching people emotionally, which is, you know, moving me too.
Absolutely.
I really wanted that reaction from people, because inside, as you've experienced, is there's the quest for what's going on. How can I be on a jet selling out arenas, be on the cover of Rolling Stone, and something's not firing right? Something's misfiring in my stomach, and I don't know what it is. Not saying I didn't have fun. I won't apologize for the debauchery. It was a great time, and I still have a great time, but there was just something missing. And that's what I get out of the diaries, more than the drug addiction, is the quest for what went wrong.
Not only is it a great read, but he's got the CD out, 6 a.m., which is a great listen.
And that's a soundtrack to the book.
Just open your eyes, just open.
So many people that come up and show me Life is Beautiful tattooed on them.
Oh, that's crazy. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, I love it.
I mean, I understand, you know, getting a Motley Crue tattoo, 25 years of doing it, but a brand new band named 6 a.m., the song is connected with them so much.
Yeah. It's beautiful.
It was just awesome meeting him at the hotel and driving with him uptown there to the Virgin Megastore.
Nikki, can we get a signature on this? Thank you.
And I got to show everybody, Nikki signed this for me.
To John.
John.
J-O-H-N?
Yeah.
Check this out. Can you guys see this? Isn't this great, man?
Thanks, man. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Nikki.
Dear John, quit calling me. Nikki Sixx.
We came into the store with him, and it's like literally we're going down the escalator. It's like Nikki, John, me, and a security guy.
Yeah. To me, I felt like we're like Motley Crue walking out on stage.
Yeah, and Nikki's got his head down, and the security guy is behind us, and the crowd just breaks in, yeah. Erupts, and John is like going like this, yeah. like they're cheering for him.
Yeah, I couldn't help myself. I had to throw up the devil horns and just go crazy. And of course, the fans were not cheering for Astronomy; they were cheering for Nikki Sixx. But it was great.
And the fans were great there. We did a lot of talking with the fans. What are you gonna say to Nikki when you get up there?
Ask her if he can sign me so I can maybe get a tattoo on tomorrow. So.
And are you, as a mother, gonna allow her to get a tattoo at age 16?
Yeah. We met in the front row at a concert the night Nikki pulled me on stage. Saw my tattoo and signed it. That was Valentine's Day. Instead of wedding rings, we got tattoos.
Nikki signed this. You had that tattooed on you, and then Nikki signed that one, and you had that tattoo. Out of control.
Now you got not only your books, which are going to be signed, obviously, but you have these panels. What's going to happen with these?
Well, I was hoping that Nikki would stay here.
I want to tell you the highlight of the book signing was when I got paddled by the Dominatrix girls.
That was crazy.
Yeah. You guys want to paddle me?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hi.
They were saving that paddle for Nikki.
And
but
the
they
one thought I was
to
trying to make
out
with her, but I actually just kissed her. I didn't make out with her.
I'm going to pass on the paddle. It was just a great honor to meet up with the one and only Nikki Sixx, who has been just a hero of mine and John's.
Absolutely.
We just feel like we've been hanging out with a friend.
Good.
And even though you don't know us at all.
Yeah, but you know what I do know? I know that you guys started doing something really cool with this show.
Thanks, man.
And Fuse is doing it, and I think it's the coolest thing. I think Fuse is the coolest network out there, and I think this is just a really important part of it.
Well, thanks.
Thank you
very much.
Thanks,
man.
After the break, an exclusive tour bus interview with Kurt from Down.
You smell like old cheese, dirty socks, and fart.
And his beard of doom, as well as more of your favorite bearded men of metal, right here on Talking Metal on Fuse. With more Talking Metal on Fuse.
Thank you, Metal Mike.
Metal Mike.
Your hand for Metal Mike. So anyway, guys, we do tons of interviews with bands on tour buses.
Yeah, I'd say most of our interviews are on tour buses.
Actually. So we thought it'd be fun to ask Kirk from Down to check out a movie and then see what he thinks of it.
Yeah, I mean, when these guys are on the road, they watch a lot of movies. So we chose Gia, made for HBO TV movie,
alrighty.
1998. Kirk's gonna come on and talk to us about it.
Cool.
It's time to put the foot to the metal with Kirk from Dow.
How's it going on tour right now, man?
It's going great. So we're just out supporting the record and enjoying ourselves.
Cool. So did you get a chance to watch the movie Gia?
Yes, I did.
What can be wrong with Angelina Jolie naked 50% of the time?
Not a thing.
Absolutely.
Here's my quick synopsis is this. Sharpen up the knives because it's a 5-razor slicer.
Absolutely.
I mean, it doesn't get any more depressing.
Yeah.
That she has a broken childhood, she rises to fame, starts doing blow, it escalates to heroin, gets addicted, gets AIDS, gets sores at the end, her hair falls out, her skin fell off her back, she bled everywhere, she died.
Do you give this a thumbs up or a thumbs down?
Oh, I give it a thumbs up for sure.
Me too.
Yeah, I give it a
I'm
thumbs
gonna
up.
I'm going to give her a thumbs up.
Three thumbs up. And Kirk, real quick before we go, I wanted to congratulate you on the new Down record. It's the third record by you guys over the under. It is getting all sorts of great write-ups, and people are talking about how good it is, so congratulations on that.
Thank you very much.
And also, just what's the whole Beard of Doom thing all about? What are these fans going crazy over?
The kids. I mean, it's pretty lovely, Johnny. It doesn't
looking
smell
good. Looking good.
My little girl says, Papa, you smell like old cheese, dirty socks, and farts.
Well, hey, Kirk, we thank you very much for taking the time out on tour to A, watch Gia, and B, come on Talking Metal on Fuse.
We sure want some metal mic to do some kind of arpeggio or something for me real quick.
Yeah, do some sweeping arpeggios or something right now, man.
He's gonna do...
My God.
Oh, yeah.
Jesus, Philomena. Thanks, guys.
All right, take care.
Take care, man.
Kirk Weinstein from Down checking in with us.
Amazing.
Over the Under, one of the albums of the year, and the year's not even over.
And he's a fan of yours, Mike.
Yeah,
that's
awesome. Totally cool.
You run into that a lot? You know, people you wouldn't think know about you, knowing about
you? Yeah, well, actually, Yngwie.
Wow.
Which was my ultimate guitar hero of all time.
Oh, absolutely.
And he was a fan of Halford stuff, and he told us that he bought Halford records because he wanted to mix his records to kind of sound like that, and it was amazing for me to hear, you know?
Wow, that's awesome.
Man. It's a dream come true.
Yeah, those are the most incredible things when you're not expecting it. Like with you guys, with Dave, for me, I would never really want to meet Yngwie myself because I didn't want to shatter the dream of my ultimate guitar hero being mean to me, right?
Right.
I still
exactly.
kind of get like that with him. Everybody
no,
else.
Believe me, I get like that with rock stars too. I don't want somebody that I love for my whole life to like be uncool and then I'm going to be devastated. And like, for example, we hung out with Nick Oliveri from Mono Generator, and he said the same thing happened when he met Jimmy Page.
Yes.
I got to meet Jimmy Page. And
that's out of control, man.
It was like, dude, you're the best. You just want to tell him, but you can't, because like, he'll leave. You know what I mean? He'll leave if you scare him off of that. So, like, all like, you want something to drink? I'll get it. Here, tell me another story about your bad back. Great, I love hearing bad back stories. You know what I mean? And then somebody ruins it in the band. That's guitar player. We had playing this guy, Brendan McNichol. He was a great guitar player, and he goes, man, I grew up listening to your music. I never forget this. He goes, I did too, mate. Like, that's all he wanted to talk about that had to do with music. Like, I did too, mate. And I was like, this guy rules. And I was like, man, my wife would really love an autograph. And that was about, I'm only going to stay for this autograph, son. What's her name, Nick?
Nick was great, man. He's got a new album out. It's called Dead Planet.
What did you like when all I wanted was goodbye?
Nick is an amazing, amazing player. Played in Caius, one of the most influential sludge metal rock bands ever. Kind of defined the genre. He also, of course, played with Queens of the Stone Age. When we spoke with Nick, he talked about playing naked on stage.
Yeah, that was down at Rock in Rio, which is out of control because it's in front of like more people than most bands ever see in their whole lifetime.
Yeah.
It was 250,000 people there. I was pretty insane. Scared, you know? So I took off all my clothes.
Good for you.
And I had a great time until they told me, get more porn! I was like, what? What's going on? I don't understand Portuguese. What did I do wrong? They just pulled me off. And this lady goes, she has a Harley Davidson hat on. No, this is a true story. She speaks in perfect English. Don't worry, there was an on-site judge who just wants an apology. And I was like, oh, I'm sorry. He had his 14-year-old daughter with him, and he didn't think it was appropriate what he did.
Right.
You know, I figured, well, Rock and Rio, there's a party.
I should have a bass in front of you.
Dude, right. I was just partying like with Jimmy Page backstage. I told him, leave me alone, dude. Come on.
I told Nick I have a MP3 on my iPod of him singing Mob Rules, Dio-era Black Sabbath, right. And got into a good discussion about Black Sabbath.
If you listen to fools, the mob rules.
I'd like to know which era you guys prefer, Ozzy Black Sabbath or Dio Black Sabbath?
Both.
Both?
Yeah, it's Ozzy for me.
Ozzy for you?
Ozzy.
Basically,
What's that?
All eyes here.
Can't stand you.
Can't stand you.
Okay.
I hate him.
Hey.
Nick, how are you?
I have to say the first six Black Sabbath records with Ozzy.
Yeah.
Although I do love Heaven and Hell, I think Heaven and Hell is a great record.
Yeah.
Mob Rules, great record. Sign of the Southern Cross. I mean, it's awesome. Everything's great. I do have to say, I do like the first six records the best.
Yeah.
They're untouchable.
Right. You know,
and they were innovative and different than anything that was happening at that time.
Nick is a great guy. His band Mono Generator is great, and we had a blast hanging out with him.
Coming up, a talking metal toast with Serj Tankian.
Cheers, guys.
Plus, some heavy news.
This is the news.
And heavy tunes, only here on Talking Metal on Fuse. But first, it's the Talking Metal Top 3 with Angela of Arch Enemy.
Hi, I'm Angela from Arch Enemy, and I've got a top 3 of vegetarian foods. Number 1 is definitely a potato leek gratin with lots of goat cheese on top. The second one is my mum's homemade quiche. What was my third? I really like to have stuffed aubergine. I stuff it with rice and tomatoes and usually some feta cheese as well, and you pop that in the oven, bring it on. I'm hungry right now.
Hi, I'm Dave Mustaine from Megadeth, and you are watching Talking Metal.
This just in, it's heavy news.
That's nice, that's nice. Metal Mike, by the way. Paul Di'Anno did the vocals on one of the greatest heavy metal records ever, Killers by Iron Maiden.
Absolutely.
He still cannot get into the United
and
States.
And he has family in the United States.
He has kids in the United States. He needs basically some money behind him so he can get a good immigration lawyer.
Right. And he's a great guy. He's a nice
guy. He's a great guy.
He's not killed anyone.
No, he's sorted out all his problems. It's just sad that Paul Di'Anno still not allowed in the United States.
It's crazy.
But one thing we can say positive about Paul is that he has released two of his records on his website for download free.
Oh, that's crazy.
You can download The Murder One from 1992 and Menace to Society.
One of our really good friends that we've met doing this podcast is Lon Friend, who I've known because I've just been a fan of Rip Magazine forever since it came out. And he told you some exclusive news recently.
Yeah, he said he is writing a book right now with two other friends, Evan Seinfeld and Tara Patrick. So we're excited to check that out. John Casimano, are you going to read this book?
I'm definitely going to read it when it comes out.
Okay, there
Hopefully
you go. Exciter from the Talking Metal forums will be reading the Lon Friend book.
Absolutely.
You guys should also read his last book,
Life on Planet Rock.
So check that one out.
Check it out.
Let's talk about tours.
Let's do some tours. There's going to be a concert I'm definitely going to, December 22nd, Madison Square Garden. Three bands that I love. Ozzy, who we've had on the podcast. Rob Zombie, Piggy D, and John Five, our good friends. And you know Rob Zombie.
I did an interview with Rob, yeah. Definitely.
Yeah, absolutely. And then we got to not forget our favorite new band in this moment.
Some other tours to mention, Killswitch Engage and Lamb of God.
Co-headline with Devil Driver and Soilwork.
Gigantor 2008. You know, when we met up with Dave, he gave us an exclusive on what's coming up with Gigantor.
Can we expect Gigantor back in the States maybe in 2008 at some point? Or?
Yes. Gigantor next year will be Megadeth, Children of Bottom, In Flames, Job for a Cowboy, and we're looking for another band right now.
We covered Gigantor before, and we will definitely be covering Gigantor again. We will never miss Megadeth again.
What else we got here?
I do believe it's the countdown to a Chinese democracy.
Chinese democracy starts now.
For the last 9 years, I've been anticipating the release of Chinese Democracy. This will be Guns N' Roses' first album of new material since 1993. Despite the years of waiting and the departure of four of the five original members, the public has not abandoned this band. And even though it's been such a long wait for Chinese Democracy, I want to go on record saying that we still believe in this record. We still believe in the man, Axl Rose.
Axl is the best frontman there's ever been.
Axl Rose is timeless.
The way that he moves and his voice is like nobody else's on this planet.
He's still on the cusp of everything new, I think.
A lot of people say to me, when is Axl gonna put back together the Appetite for Destruction lineup and do a reunion tour? I say I hope never. You cannot deny the power of the original five and what they did back in the late 80s. But you also cannot deny the power of the current band. We know the new lineup is great because we've seen them play many times in concert. We know the new songs are great because we've heard unfinished mixes of them. And we know Chinese Democracy will be nothing short of amazing.
Of course, I wish it was out, but when it does come out, I'm pretty much just gonna sit in a room for 2 days with my head equidistant between the left and right speaker, just blasting it.
When Chinese Democracy comes out, most likely I will be celebrating naked in my apartment.
A massive league of loyal fans continue to keep the legacy of Guns N' Roses alive. And whenever Chinese Democracy finally drops, the fans' patience will be rewarded.
Mark, not only do we love the classic metal, but we also like some really cool new bands.
Hey gang, it's time for the Metal Detector.
Metal Mike is
Metal
so
Mike.
Freaking awesome.
He's amazing.
All right,
let's hear Metal Mike.
What are we listening to, dude?
Right now, I'm listening to a band called The Showdown.
The Showdown. The Showdown. Showdown, right here. They're young guys, and they have these big, big hooks. I highly recommend you check out Temptation Come My Way. These guys are out of Tennessee. Check them out. Enough about them. We have Overloaded.
That guy always sends us Eric. He sends us his stuff all the time.
Eric is a fan of Talking Metal. We are a fan of Overloaded. Regeneration is the latest Overloaded. Check that one out, too. We have The Agonist, Century Media.
I like these guys. I like them, too.
Another band.
You discovered this band.
Another band on Century Media, fronted by a female, rocking out. Big hooks, but yet keeping it hardcore and stuff.
Right.
Definitely check out The Agonist. Their record is called Once Only Imagined. So that's about it for the Metal Detector.
Check them all out.
This has been the Metal Detector. I've detected some metal in my hands. Coming up, John and Mark unwind with Serj Tankian.
I'm overbooked to nightlife.
And work up a sweat with Bumblefoot and Frank Ferrer of Guns N' Roses.
They know I'm running wild.
Talking Metal on Fuse. We'll be right back.
Had the pleasure of hanging out at our favorite bar in New York City,
Circus
Bar. Big Talking Metal toast
to Circus.
And our good new friend, Serj.
Talking Metal toast. Cool. Cheers, guys.
Cheers. Serj has got an amazing new record out, and I'm not just saying that because we're on Fuse right now.
Right.
The new record is amazing. Elect the Dead.
As a System fan, this is a record that appeals to me, and this is definitely a rock record. Rock fans are gonna like it, metal fans are gonna like it. Was that a conscious effort, or is this just kind of where you fell?
It wasn't really a conscious effort at all. In fact, I didn't even know it was gonna be a rock record.
Don't you see their bodies burning? Yes, I let them full of yearning, dying of anticipation, choking from intoxication.
What I did was I just picked songs that I wrote either on piano or acoustic guitar that were very classic types of songs, you know? Because I have a huge library of songs. I have hundreds of unreleased songs, all sorts of genres, electronic and experimental and whatnot, and these were just very simple songs for me that I wanted to sing over, and they had this emotion about them. They're a lot more classical music and operatic oriented than anything I've ever done, so it surprised me that I was coming up with the rock record, because my intention wasn't that in the first place.
Right.
I want you to be
behind those empty walls.
Sometimes the song themselves beg the instruments that need to be on them.
Speaking of the instruments, you played like 90% of the stuff on this record, yeah, which is great, because I knew you played guitar, but I didn't know you played like all the other instruments as well.
Yeah, well, piano was my first instrument, so I would say about 60-65% of the songs were written on piano. I like doing string arrangements. I've been doing it for film and for System records and stuff, even though it's buried in the mix with System stuff, but guitar was my second instrument. I've been playing it for at least 20 years. Bass, you know, same. Right. Technique kind of thing. Honestly, I'm not the best singer in the world, I'm not the best guitarist in the world, I'm not the best of anything in the world, but I'm the best at presenting things that I have in mind, you know? So I was able to do that with these songs in a very honest and organic way.
Serj is a great guy. We had some great conversation with him.
Growing up, I hate to tell you this, but growing up, I wasn't even a metal fan.
Really?
The first concert I went to was Iron Maiden in 1984, and my girlfriend was a fan. Oh, so okay. She took me, and I was like, whoa. Wow, you know, my eyes started opening up. Maiden is a very unique band, I've realized over the years, because of their rhythm, the way that they play the music, their rhythmical pattern, guitars and bass, the whole kind of riding a horse kind of thing. We've used it a lot in System, not necessarily right. Copying it, but being influenced by it. Maiden is a very specific influence that I think you could point out in bands, because it's a very rhythmical thing.
Talking Sabbath, Maiden, Tony Iommi.
Absolutely.
You've done a lot of collaborations, you know, everybody from the Deftones to Snot to Buckethead.
Yeah.
But I wanted to ask you about collaborating with the great godfather of metal, Tony Iommi, on the song Patterns.
I had met him through Ozfest and a number of shows we had played opening up for Black Sabbath in Europe and stuff. So he had sent me a tape of a song to listen to, and I thought it was really cool. And I started playing around with, you know, vocal ideas and lyrics and stuff. And then I went and met him, hung out with him, and, you know, just chilled and just talked about music and hung out, you know.
Cool.
And then I went into the studio and just cracked it.
Some drunk guy coming in the middle of the interview and interrupting
We've met
stuff.
That guy before.
Yeah, I knew there was going to be trouble when we walked into the Circus Bar and I saw that dude hanging out.
I have a number of tracks that I've done with him, some really, really weird man, that we've done together.
Big shots.
And Sorry, that threw me off.
Again, Serj, the great singer of System of a Down, one of my favorite bands of the last 10 years, joining us on Talking Metal and talking some metal.
I move as fast as I can. I like to get around.
Coming up, Mark and John get themselves into a real jam with Bumblefoot and Frank of Guns N' Roses when Talking Metal on Fuse returns.
Cause when they see me coming,
and we're back with more Talking Metal on Fuse.
Now, John, you have jammed with actual members of KISS. I mean, you were on stage singing backing vocals with Ace Frehley.
Right.
And you actually played Detroit Rock City. You were playing guitar with Paul Stanley.
Yeah, I played with Paul Stanley and Bruce Kulick and Glenn Hughes of Deep Purple, and it was a blast. I actually did Paul's part, and Bruce Kulick did, you know, his part.
Right, and Paul was just doing vocals, right?
Paul was just singing, so that's why I was playing guitar.
Well, we went recently to hang out with two fellow KISS fans, Frank and Bumblefoot of Guns N' Roses.
Talking Metal calling.
Hey.
What's up, man?
How you doing?
Ready to go, man. Frank!
So we thought we were going to jam with Frank and Bumblefoot, and the next thing you know, he stuck me to work.
We just got to do something real quick before we jam.
I'm not a real handy guy.
Yeah.
That's right, you're going to be. This is not going to take long at all. Alrighty, so the first thing we're going to do is we got to touch up these yellow walls here.
My band actually used to open up for
Bumblefoot.
My wife's band has opened up for Frank's older band, Pisser, and... Honky Toast was his band before that. Two great bands.
We did gigs together at that little shithole. What was that fucking place? Images.
Flash forward like 6 years, maybe 7 years. I'm at a sold out
Hammerstein
show. It's kind of the return of Guns N' Roses, and there's this big mystery. Who's gonna come out and be the replacement for Buckethead? And out walks Bumblefoot.
I couldn't see that far, and I go, who's the guitar player? And you go, it's Bumblefoot.
The next time they came through town, Frank joins up with the band, played the Garden, sold out, and we ran into you backstage.
Right.
Yeah. How was that playing the Garden?
Dream come true.
Well, the cool thing is that we ended up in his studio, and we got to play with two members of Guns N' Roses.
Which I think is out of control.
It's time for Talking Metal's first numero uno, Metal J.
Bumblefoot, what's your favorite Judas Priest record?
Said Rings of Destiny.
How does my
The live record, Unleashed and Ease.
Oh, I see. I'm as fast as I can. I like to get around. I'm crazy like a bat.
I stood up from the kid, let him sit down, and I went and played Dizzy's Congress.
Oh, awesome.
Out to get me.
Don't change it, hold me down. Always break away. And never hear society. Tell me what to do or say. I'll taste the night that freezes me. Or raise the storm through all the world to see. I am a stumble, never fall, never stop for rest. I'm about what I want tall, and I demand respect. I move amongst the nightlife, and they just step aside. Cause when they see me coming, they know I'm running wild. I'm running wild.
You need cock for the whole.
Yeah, maybe you should try a little cock. You can try that.
Cock's tripping.
Yeah, I'm not into the cock. I think this was a success.
We played with members of Guns N' Roses.
I think it turned out great. I mean,
it was
awesome.
It was out of control.
John, I think the first show went really, really well. I'm looking forward to doing more Talking Metal with you on Fuse.
Make sure you check us out on TalkingMetal.com, and let's hear it for the first episode of Talking Metal. Let's do a Talking Metal toast.
Talking Metal toast. Yeah.